All right, in James, the author is the major leader of the Jerusalem church. He's the half-brother of Jesus, probably from a previous marriage of Joseph, if the proto-evangelium of Jacob is correct. We have an early source from the second century at a time when people from Jesus' family are still alive that says that Joseph was married, that he had several children, that his first wife died, and that he had an oversight marriage with Mary as a second marriage. Therefore, Jesus had half-brothers, but they weren't through Mary. If that is true, James appears to be the oldest of them, and he is called James the Just, or James the Tzaddik, the one who would be the elder following Joseph, who was a tzaddik or a righteous man or an elder in a congregation. All of that we don't know for sure. All of that is historical, and it may or may not be true. But what we do know is that the book appears to be written before the Jerusalem Council in 50. This is probably the earliest of the epistles written. It's not the earliest epistle of Paul, but it's the earliest epistle. And this one written by the pastor of the Jerusalem church, whose name is James. It is written to first century Jewish believers who are scattered all over the world, and as well as future Bible readers like us, and especially for believers feeling pressure from society's influences. These Jewish believers were spread out now in a Gentile world, and identity is always an issue for Jews, always. And as a result, they're trying to figure out exactly how to live out this new faith of the people of the way or follow Jesus. And so the pastor of the Jerusalem church is the appropriate one to write the first letter. You would expect that the earliest letter was written by a Jewish pastor, a messianic pastor, and it is. There are some prescriptions that are involved in the book, and I pick out three in particular, three prescriptions that the book makes. One of them is I have to understand what I'm responsible for and what I'm not. As a believer, there are things you're responsible for, but there are many things that you're not responsible for. People who take responsibility for things that are not theirs to be responsible for become dysfunctional people. Some of you blame yourself for things that are not your responsibility. There was no way you could control them, but you feel badly when they go wrong, as if somehow you are to blame. One of the things that this very early epistle does is it makes the difference, or runs a line of difference, between testing and tempting. What is a test and what is a temptation? I would say the second thing that this book does is reminds early Jewish followers of Jesus to watch their mouths, to be careful about how they speak. The third one is to be very careful about the class distinctions they make among believers. That is, that they are to treat believers, poor and rich, young and old, as believers. The problem is this: if you grew up in a Jewish society and now you're part of the believing society of followers of Jesus and you're being ostracized from Judaism, it's hard to know who your circle is. You go through this awkward thing where all of a sudden you don't feel right in your old setting anymore, and you don't know where your new setting is, and that's part of the purpose of the book. Now, let's take a few minutes and just take a look at chapter 1 and do an irreducible minimum if we can. I'm just going to give you my run at it. You can put in what you want, but let's begin with our underlining. Verse 1, James to the 12 tribes dispersed. James to the 12 tribes dispersed. Verse 2, consider it all joy when you encounter various trials. Verse 3, testing produces endurance. Verse 4, let endurance result. Verse 5, if lack wisdom, ask. If you want, ask God, that's fine, but I think that's pretty much obvious. If lack wisdom, ask. or ask of God. Six, in faith, seven, just use the word not. Verse 8, double-minded. So ask in faith, not double-minded. That's how we're doing it. 12, blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. Verse 13, let no one say, I am being tempted by God. 14, each is tempted by his own lust. Each is tempted by his own lust. 17, every good gift is from above. 19, everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. Put aside all filthiness. Put aside all filthiness. 22, prove yourselves doers of the word. 25, one who looks intently and abides will be blessed. 26, religious yet does not bridle his tongue, deceives. 27, pure and undefiled religion, visit orphans and widows. Keep unstained. 28, when you go to chapter 1, there are two issues in chapter 1. I want you to draw a line between verses 12 and 13. The first issue is in verses 1 through 12. The second issue is in verses 13 all the way to the end of the chapter. And in verse 1, the issue is that God is often behind the weight of my troubles, teaching me endurance. God is often behind the weight of my troubles, teaching me endurance. In other words, trouble isn't troublesome. Often, trouble is God at work. And so when we look at troubles as though they're a pest or as though there's something wrong, we're not really recognizing that often God is at work. He's training me for a better future by challenging me in the present. It's the same thing you do when you're trying to build muscle. You have to work at tearing it down, then giving it a chance to heal, then building it again, tearing it down, giving it a chance to heal, building it again. The point is that James instructs us about trouble in the first 12 verses. Now, go to the first one. James, a bondservant of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes who are dispersed abroad. Notice who the readers are. This is, first of all, who is James? It's the Lord's half-brother. His name in Hebrew is Yaakov, Jacob. The word James is Yaakov, is Jacob. So we know that he's not the James, the brother of John, because the brother of John dies in Acts 12. But the fact of the matter is, it appears to be, he is probably the one leading the Jerusalem Council in Acts 15. So you might make a note that he's the pastor who was in Acts 15 who said, this is what we're going to do. He's the leader. Clearly, he's the designated first leader of the early church and chosen to be the chief elder of the Jerusalem church. Now, who were the recipients of the letter? In verse 1, these are first century dispersed Jews. This is not a metaphor for Christians. This is 12 tribes scattered abroad, which is Jews. So these are Jewish believers. And in fact, in chapter 2, verse 2, I would put next to verse 1, chapter 2, verse 2, which mentions the word synagogue in the Greek text. In your synagogues. So it's so early that they're not calling their meetings anything unique or special like church. They're using the term synagogue. The whole thing is that What he's trying to do is make it very clear that he's sending this to Jewish people who have been traveling around or scattered around as a part of being in the diaspora. Now, when you get to verse 2, he starts his first subject. His first subject is the trouble with troubles. And he's going to outline 6 troubles here with troubles. And the first one is in verses 2 and 3. When trouble comes, my heart sours because I don't see the point. That's what verses 2 and 3 say. When trouble comes, my heart sours. I don't see the point. He says, consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials. Does anybody know anybody who automatically defaults to, oh, great, something went wrong? People like that are on drugs. They have problems. They're not normal. So obviously, the natural reaction to verse 2 is, when trials come, I get sour in heart because I don't see the point. But he says, I want you to consider it all joy, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. Now, I know that some of you are much more athletic than I ever was, but I can tell you that my body speaks to me. When I begin running, my body says, stop this now, or I'm going to have a heart attack and kill you where you stand. My lungs say, we're burning down here, stop this right now. When I climb up the side of a mountain, my legs start saying, why are you doing this to me? I've been a perfectly good leg for all of your years. Why are you torturing me in this way? And my body starts screaming to me. Generally, when I'm doing that, I'm doing it with a group, so I don't let them know that I'm having all of these attacks inside. I just don't let them see me sweat as I continue to go. But here's what he says, a painfully literal reading of verses 2 and 3. Okay, listen to my painfully literal reading. Lead the way, the word consider is actually lead the way in moving your mind toward delight, particularly at the time when an array of proving tests is dropped into your life. When you rejoice in these things, you show that you have grown in certainty and prove you have gained a truly biblical worldview. It demonstrates that you've come to understand what God is doing for you. The heavy weight of trouble is God's way of building up your ability to remain under great stress. That's my painfully literal translation of the Greek words. In other words, when I go through trials, I stop, and if I can consider them part of God's training, I gain perspective on the trials. Now, there's a couple of myths that are in the background of our life and people believe them. You need to hear them and know what they are. First, if I follow God, my life will be easier. Total myth. Read the word L-I-E. If I follow God, my life will be easier. If that were true, the Bible is filled with inaccurate accounts because from David to Moses, from John the Baptizer to Paul, this is an account filled with the people of God who go uphill against struggles to do right. So let's get off the page that somehow my life should be easier. By the way, another myth. God is interested in making my life easier. Total myth. It's a lie. God is not interested in making your life easier. Another one, easier is better. Another myth, easier is not better. If everything in your life becomes easier and easier, you may enjoy doing things more, but it's not better for you. If we could just never have to stand up, but we just had these automatic chairs that just transported us around, and we never had to do, we could just think it, and we could just be taken there, and if we could just, you know, imagine something and it would appear in front of us. That would be easier, but your muscle tension in your body would dramatically decrease and your fat content would dramatically increase. How about another myth? If God is in the plan, it will work easier. Is that true? If God is in the plan, it will work easier. No, but I'm going to tell you something. You're going to work with ministry teams the world over, and they're going to think that that's true. Well, God was in it because, man, it just all fell together. Well, God is still in it even if it didn't. Even if it all fell apart, God may be in it. Okay? So let me stretch that a little bit further. There's a lot of us that have what I call the mommy myth about God. We think that it's only logical that since our mom loved us and her love was profoundly shown in keeping us from pain and discomfort, that the only way to show tenderness is provide comfort and guard against anything that would cause pain. That's a mommy myth. The Bible is clear. God is your heavenly father, not your heavenly mother. Okay? I need you to transition your thinking. Dads have a different way about them. It isn't that dads don't care. It's that they have a sense of how tough it's going to be, and they want you to be tough enough to face it. I just want you to play with that idea a little bit. Now, get down to verse 4. Let's do another trouble. The first trouble, obviously, was that when troubles come, my heart sours. That's verses 2 and 3. Verse 4, the second trouble I have with troubles is when trouble comes, I seek to escape, not to get stronger. Verse 4, let endurance have its perfect result so that you may be complete, perfect, lacking nothing. So in verse 4, he says, listen, it's going to be a knee-jerk reaction when trouble comes to get away from it, but let it work on you. In other words, instead of constantly asking for God to make life easier, I ought to constantly be asking God to make me stronger. You know that old saying, whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Well, I'm not saying go out there and try to, you know, get hit by as many trucks as possible to grow in strength. I'm saying that when something happens in your life and it becomes trouble that you did not cause, your first stop is don't let your heart get sour. Ask what God is teaching you. Your second stop is don't try to run from it. Ask how God can build in you the endurance you need so that every setback that happens in your life can help you. James is saying you have to deal with your attitude about trouble. If you don't, nothing else will help. How many of you have gone through trouble and gotten the grumpies, and as a result, you started whining, and it just, the size of the trouble grew? I don't know why I have to go through this, and the trouble grows as you ascribe more power to it. Once I believe that God's preparing me for something, I have the ability to look at the strains and troubles like a training athlete. Yes, it's true. This muscle hurts, but you know what? If I keep working it, it's going to get better. Yes, it's true. I can't run the whole race, but you know I'm running 50% more than I did a few weeks ago, and as I train, I'm gaining ground. Yes, it's true. I'm 10 pounds overweight, but I was 20 and now I've lost half. You have to be able to see it as a process that you're moving through. You know, when I need a needle, I don't want to need a needle, but I need one. There's times when you need to go to a doctor and what they need to do is give you a shot. It's not what you want. If you're a person who goes, I love shots, there's something wrong with you. Okay? But you know, the truth of the matter is sometimes I know that that's what I need. Now, I can avoid people who give them. I can avoid going and getting one, but it's what I need. Let me say it this way. Trouble is part of the need of your life if you're going to be enduring in a fallen world. You're going to have some toughness. Now, let me give you a third trouble. James argues that I have to deal with my patience in trouble if I want to be ready to be used by God for greater things. Look at verse 5. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. Would you make a note in your Bible that the wisdom in verse 5 is about trials? The verse 5 doesn't say, anything you want to know, ask God and he'll tell you. That's not what it says. What it says, if any of you lack wisdom, in the context of trouble. If trouble comes into your life and you don't know why, what do? You can ask God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. You can say, God, I don't understand this trouble in my life. I'm not saying to you that I'm not going to follow you. I am going to follow you, but could you give me some indication of what it is I'm supposed to be learning? And he will give you indication of what you're supposed to be learning. So when trouble comes, what do? I don't run from trouble. I run to God. Because I understand why he let it happen. I start asking him, Lord, why is this happening? James says something that's worth remembering. When you are getting pummeled by life and you don't understand why, God's the right person to ask. The wrong person to ask are five other people in your life. They don't know, but God is the right person. There's something desperately wrong in the life of a believer that allows troubles to pummel them without seeking God. There's something wrong with that. And I have known some people whose back was broken by the weight of trouble, but they did not seek God. The trouble is supposed to lead you not just to run from trouble, but to run into the arms of God and ask. Now, not all trouble comes from God directly. Sometimes bad things happen because I live in a fallen world, right? And obviously, you know, tornadoes and hurricanes are all part of living in a fallen world. They're not directed at you. God is not chasing you with a tornado. The fact of the matter is he's doing it as a part of a general system of a fallen world. But sometimes bad things happen because I live on a planet filled with rebellious men and women, and the leaves of my neighbor's sin blow over onto my well-manicured life. It happens. Sometimes bad things happen because I've been careless in my preparation and I haven't done what is necessary. If you don't fill your gas tank, don't get mad at God when you run out of gas. It's not his fault. You didn't stop at the gas station. It's not like you didn't know it needed gas. Not like you didn't see the gas station. You didn't choose to stop. The fact is, there's a lot of reasons that troubles come into our lives. But sometimes I have to use my lifeline. I have to ask God the question, what am I supposed to be learning here? Now, what I think is interesting is what I should not do is assume that God has somehow become uninterested in me. And that is something people do. Trouble came, so God must not love me. Or maybe God's mad at me. Or maybe he really wanted to send thunderbolts at me. Listen, God's normal act of giving trouble into your life is to build you, not break you. Okay? I would say this. Don't look at trouble like it's a woodshed moment with God, where God's going to give you a licking for doing something bad. That might not be the case. By the way, it could be. But most often in my life, it's been, I have to ask God what it is I really want, what I think he wants me to hear from this. James argues that I have to set aside my doubt about trouble and ask God if I want to be more effective. So look at verses 6 and 7. When trouble comes, one of the things that happens is my prayer wobbles because I'm not certain I can trust God. Look at verses 6 and 7 and remember this. The single greatest test for a believer is God really good? If you haven't been through this test, you will be through this test. This will happen in your life. And this is what he says. But he must ask in faith without any doubting. And doubting about what? Doubting that God can hear him. Doubting that God is good. Doubting that God wants him to know. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For the man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. The double-mindedness is about the goodness of God. The point is, did you ever try to stand up in a small boat in rough sea? If you ever get out on a rough water or in a canoe with your roommate, what happens is you're going to stumble around if you don't hang on to something in rough seas. The point is, when we don't really count on God to come through, we dishonor God. When we don't count on God to be good, we dishonor God's character. And so James argues that I have to directly address my prayer life if I want troubles to sculpt me into something that's pleasing to the Lord. I want troubles to work on me the same as I would want bodybuilding to sculpt my body. I want troubles to sculpt my soul. Let me say it this way. Verses 9 through 11, when trouble comes, an unwanted reminder surfaces. And here it is. Control is an illusion. Verses 9 through 11. But the brother of humble circumstances is to glory in his high position, and the rich man is to glory in humiliation, because like flowering grass he will pass away. For the sun rises with a scorching wind and withers the grass, and the flower falls off, and the beauty of its appearance is destroyed. So too the rich man in the midst of his pursuits will fade away. Look, the text does not argue for me to feel good about somebody else's fortune. They went through misfortune. Oh, goody. That's not what it's about. I'm not supposed to be cheering on other people's pain. Oh, good. They finally got what they deserved. That's not what he's talking about. It can sound like that, but that's not what he's saying. On close examination, the whole behavior is ungodly. What James is driving at here is the reality that we live a life of illusion. We walk around thinking that if I eat right, if I exercise, if I go to bed on time, if I wake up in the morning and I make all responsible decisions, I won't get cancer. That's not true. You don't have control. The number of the days of your life has already been determined, and you don't control it. That does not give you an excuse not to eat right, but you don't eat right because of the result. You eat right because you're stewarding what God gave you. I vote not because I control the election, but because I'm called to be a good citizen. I do right because it honors God, not because I will get right as a result. Boy, this is going all the way back to Genesis now, isn't it? Do right, get right. Do wrong, get wrong. That's a baby Christian. The grown-up view is you might do right and get wrong in this life because it's a fallen world, but that's okay. Because at the end, I did right. I honored my Savior, and that's what I was called to do with my life. You might work hard. You might be the person who's there early, who shuts the lights out at night, and they may lie about you and you lose the job. I only see it all the time. Don't do right to get right. Do right to honor God. And when I get down to verses 9 through 11, what I do is I realize life is short. And the only thing that's going to matter is something beyond this life. When I hear Jesus say, well done, good and faithful servant. See, here's my point. I'm not in control. My life is not in my hands. My wealth, my health, my nation, these are all beyond my ability. They're beyond my cunning. I live in a world with powers and forces greater than mine. So I have to step back and understand control is an illusion. That's what it is. Now, get all the way to verse 12, because this is the end of this section. James argues, I have to see clearly in the midst of my troubles if I want them to perform their work in me. So how does he say it? When trouble comes, I can feel like it's a penalty or a curse, but that's because I fail to see the opportunity to please God in the middle of the trouble. Look at verse 12. Blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. For once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. James says that some people can be trounced by troubles and still be blessed. The key is perseverance until proof emerges that God is pleased, even if that proof comes after he's dead. So, the bottom line is we have to remember that God never misses a tear cried in the pain of injustice. He never misses it. Don't be deceived into thinking that life right now is going to make sense right now, because it might not. The fact of the matter is you might do everything right, still get wrong, and it'll only make sense after you're standing in the presence of Jesus. So James argues I have to look past this life to see the real benefit of troubles. If I had a single sentence for verses 1 through 12, it's James argues I have to look past this life to make sense of troubles in this life. I've got to look past it to make any sense out of it. It's really, really hard. A few years ago, Anderson Cooper, when he was first coming on to CNN, they had a commercial for him, and it showed a man sitting on a hay wagon being pulled by a donkey. And the whole idea was they had this beautiful shot of this man coming down a road, and there was a big hay bulging out of the back, hay bales bulging, and he was riding. And then the frame opened up, and you could see that beside him was a tank and a couple of soldiers. And just by opening the frame, it changed the perspective of what the actual picture was. What James is arguing is you see the trouble, I need you to move out and see the frame as beyond this life, and its purpose is bigger than you see. Now, I want to shift gears with you for a minute, because if the first half of chapter 1 is about troubles that are not your fault, things you did not do anything wrong, God introduced them or superintended them in your life to help sculpt your soul, the second half is about something else. Look at verse 13, because from verses 13 to 27, this is an entirely different subject. Guys, it is terribly important that you understand James 1, that the first half has to do with trouble that is not caused by me. God introduces trouble or signs off on trouble, indirectly allows trouble. By the way, Christians get all funny of, did God give me the trouble or did God let me have the trouble? Frankly, when I'm in trouble, I don't care. When I'm in turbulence in the aircraft, I don't care if Satan's blowing on it and God let him or God is shaking it. All I know is it's shaking and I don't want shaking. I want smooth. Okay? So don't tell me all about the theology of jumping through, well, actually God allowed. I don't care. I don't like trouble. Do you? But the only way for my soul to be sculpted into something usable by God is for me to go through some troubles. Now, in verse 13, there's something completely different. There's a voice within. Verse 13, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself does not tempt anyone. Here's the thing. God may place in your life weight, as in heaviness, but he will never place in your life bait. He won't bait you to do wrong. Like, here's wrong, come and get me. That's not God. It happens, but it's not God. So trouble might come into my life as a weight on my life to build soul muscle. But temptation is never from God. So here's the truth. The first voice is the fallen conscience. See, before you came to know Jesus, the Bible says you were physically alive, but you were spiritually dead. Ephesians 2 recalls that the believer was dead in sin. Now, there was an echo in your old life of spirit connection. The spirit was torn away in the Garden of Eden in rebellion, but there was a leftover in your DNA set of old spirit rules. They're called conscience. You had a conscience and it's fallen, but it nevertheless still exists in most people. Now the problem is the conscience has become overly superstitious, naive, and wholly unreliable. Okay, it's been coached by a world that has fallen. It's probably best pictured in my youth by two little men that hung out on the shoulders of Fred Flintstone. You know, good guy, bad guy. Here's the thing. A call to do right versus a call to do wrong is a fallen worldview. It's disconnected. Here's what you have. At one time you had God in a spiritual intimate walk. In the garden, the umbilical cord of spiritual life was disconnected and you died spiritually. You were born physically alive, dead spiritually, but with a little bit of remembrance in the conscience of what a walk with God was about. It was built into you. Now, here's the thing. When I look at this, what I see is that I have in my life, according to Romans 7, the old man, the flesh, even as a new man. When I come to Jesus Christ, the Spirit is connected again to my life and I become alive. But just like the conscience exists in the fallen person, so the old man exists in the now spiritually alive person. Does that make sense? So just like even before you were saved, you had a nagging conscience, after you're saved, you have a nagging old man. Each of us has a piece of our old life. Okay? Now, here's the key to 13 to 27. Identifying the voices within is essential to developing a defense and a counterattack. In other words, I got to know what the voice is to know how to attack. Or how to hold up my, I gotta know where the punch is coming from so I know which way to hold up my hands, or I'm gonna get hit, okay? So, first James says, we don't understand God's nature. And the whole first section of James 1 through 12, is all about how we don't understand. And then he says, James explains, we don't recognize our own nature. Verse 13, don't let anybody say it's God that's tempting me. You don't understand where it's coming from. It's not coming from God. But verse 14 tells you where it is coming. Each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by what? His own lust, his own desires. When you say lust, somehow you sensualize it. It's just he's carried away because he wants to be. We want to do what we want to do. So he says, The problem is we don't understand where it's coming from. So we're out there going, I got to defend myself from God. And guess what? You're holding up your hands like this, but it's coming from within. You're getting pummeled from inside. God isn't testing you by giving you some special temptation. That's coming from you. Do you ever meet people who are totally wrong about the direction of where their trouble's coming from? They'll say to you something like, I didn't mean to be falling that way, but the devil, he was all over me. The devil wasn't all over you. The devil didn't even have to know your name that day. You are all over you. Your heart's desire was to do wrong. The devil made me lie. No. In most cases, you just plain wanted to. Verse 15, watch what he says. Then when lust has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. How many of you look at that and go, boy, that's a weird image. Lust is conceived, it brings forth or gives birth to sin. What's the point of conceived, eventually gives birth, eventually dies? The life cycle. What is the point to saying the first half of verse 15 the way he says it? Ask yourself the question, what is the growing of a child in a womb? It's a process. Sin is not an instantaneous event. It's a process. That's what he just said. He just said, it's not when you did wrong. It's the time between you thought about doing wrong and you did wrong. That was the process. In other words, if in verse 13 I recognize God didn't do it, and in verse 14, I recognize it's really my heart that's the problem. Then in verse 15, I have to understand there's a process involved in it. I will never defeat sin if I am mystified about the process. So he said there's a time between the conception of the idea and the action of the sin. And the sin isn't just the action, it's the whole process. That's why Jesus said it's not adultery in the bed, it's in your head. You're already in the process, hooked to the sin, while you're allowing your mind to develop and grow the baby. That's what he's trying to tell you. There's a process. And what's important is, when lust is conceived, it gives birth to sin, the action. And when sin accomplishes its purpose is death. Now, that sounds a little ridiculous. You have sinned already today in some area, and you're still alive. That's not what he's saying. He's saying the process of sin is to kill your walk with God. That's what it's to do. So as the sin then is produced, it produces its natural result, which is death to sensitivity to God, death to walking with God with guiltlessly. Guilt is the weed in the garden of innocence. That's what it is. It grows up in order to create ways of sucking out of the soil life so that you can't produce what you want. So all of a sudden, instead of going to God and seeing Him do great things in your life, you're going to God and spending half your prayer time in guilt, confessing things in your life. And part of the death isn't that you died, it's that something that God's life God wanted to flow through you isn't there right now. So the process of sin is what I have to identify. But the purpose of sin is to sap life away. That's what it does. So, verse 16, do not be deceived, my beloved brothers, is sin is not only a process, it's also a sneaky one. It's easy for us, living in a fallen world, to lose track of the deception. So here's, what's a deception you have about sin? One of them is, it's not so bad, or God's really not that upset about it. We tend to minimize what sin is to the Lord. We tend to normalize our life and sort of stabilize with a certain level of sin. We have a certain amount of sin in our life. You know, look, you're going to eat a certain amount of dirt in your life, and then, you know, what is it, a peck of dirt you eat in your life? So you just get used to there's going to be some dirt in the food. It's always going to be a hair somewhere along the line. You'll eat it. You won't even know you ate it. And that's just part of life. And so we do that with sin. We just, there's a certain amount of sin you're going to have in your life. And that's just, and then we start gauging ourselves not against the standard of God, but against the standard of our neighbor. Why? Because we're easily deceived. Temptation begins as a thought It can be encouraged by the world or the devil, but it need not be. It can be a leftover from fallen life, and it's nothing more than an appeal in seed form. But here's where we go wrong. We nurture the thought. We allow it to develop and grow. We let it keep us transfixed and inattentive to the wrong. And as we let it grow, its power over us becomes invincible. All of a sudden, we don't have the strength to stop it. Now, the problem is, it's really easy. James answers three problems with three answers. Look at verse 17. The first problem is, if we think God is baiting us, we need to recognize the Bible's revelation of God's true nature. Every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting shadow. In other words, God's nature is always good. He defines good. It's never changing. It's ever offering us something that will complete us. Sin kills life. God doesn't send killing influences to cut off. God's influence, God's desire is to have an intimate personal relationship with you. It's not to stop that relationship. Sin's desire is to take away from the relationship. The second thing I think is in verse 18. In verse 18 it says, in the exercise of his will he brought us forth by the word of truth. Now notice he's using in verse 18 the same analogy as verse 15. The word brought us forth is the word to be born, to come from the womb. Okay? In exercise of his will, he made us alive or birthed the baby by the word of truth so that we would be a kind of first fruits among his creatures. How are you first fruits among his creatures? See, lions are fallen, but they're not being redeemed. Dogs are fallen, but they're not being redeemed. Whales are fallen, but they're not being redeemed. Zebras are fallen, and they're not being redeemed. Stars are fallen, but they're not being redeemed. You're the first thing being redeemed, and eventually all creation will be redeemed. So you are the first of God's remaking. The new living character of God beginning to move through the life of a person will end up in a lion that can sit down beside a wolf, and neither will need to eat each other. Why? Because eventually their redemption will come. Bless you. So in verse 18, if we fail to recognize the voice within us beckoning us to do wrong, we allow temptation to grow into sin. But conversely, in verse 18, if we allow God's will to work in us through truth, we give birth to right things and become the beginning of God's hostile takeover of his former fallen planet. And that bottom line is in verse 19, he goes on and he says, if we're conscious of the process of temptation, we also have our answer. God deliberately responded to the growth of lust and powerful temptation within us by planting the seed of yet another growth process alongside of it, which is a hunger to know God. So alongside of the seeds of sin that are left in your life, there's also a seed of desire to know God. And so in verse 19, it says, this you know, my beloved brethren, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. What is he saying? He's saying everybody should take responsibility to overcome temptation. I have to slow down my response. Now listen to me very carefully, because this is one that I don't know if you've grasped yet. We haven't seen it in previous verses. One of the great tools of the enemy is to bring on life so quickly you can't get equilibrium. He'll bring on various troubles one after the other, and you can't solve them because you're getting hit in too many directions. That's why verse 19 says, slow down. What's going to happen is the enemy creates emergency in you, urgency in you, by hitting you in many directions at one time. You have to understand, the enemy does not throw a single punch. He throws multiple combination punches. He'll hit you in three directions at the same time. That's why sometimes we're going through trouble here, and sometimes I know it's an attack. What's the difference? An attack is when we're getting hit on three or four sides all at one time. Okay? If it's one problem, that's just living in a fallen world. But when it's a combo punch, and we're getting hit in four directions, I know the enemy's at work. How do I know it? Because he's speeding up the process of troubles one after another. I want you to think of Job 1. Do you remember? Job was there, and while he was yet speaking, one came in and said, "Oh, the wind smote your house and it crushed the people." And while he was yet speaking, the Sabaeans came in and took away your camels. And while he was yet speaking, while. That's the enemy. Job 1 is a picture of the enemy pummeling somebody. So even though very often temptation is coming within, attacks can come without. And the difference is that I have to perceive the level of the punch I'm going through and how many are in the combination. You're not going to try to, you know, you didn't get up this morning and say, I'm going to sin 8 ways in the next hour. No, but you can get up and have 8 things go wrong in 1 hour, and then you're getting pummeled from the outside, and what it's doing is causing you to go off balance. One of the ways, I was reading something yesterday written by a community organizer who was advising people how to bring socialism into a democratic society. And what he said was, if you want to throw off a democratic society and get it under a regime, the way you do is create very startling emergencies all over the place. If you start to see that, what you're seeing is something that's being deliberately planted in front of you. People will go, "We got to do something about this. We got to do something about this." The problem existed the day before, but suddenly it's an emergency. One of the things you're going to see, get used to this. People will come in and they'll say, we've got to handle this right now. No, we don't. We need to stop. We need to be, look at what he says. Be quick to hear. That is, investigate what the problem is before you try to create an answer. Be slow to speak. That is, don't give your answer until you've heard everything. Slow to anger. That is, don't let it attack your ego and get your back up. You don't think well when you're afraid. You don't think well when you panic, and you don't think well when you're angry. So you have to stop and step back and go, okay, let me hear the whole thing first. Now, what's interesting is that the world is beckoning your lusts within. The enemy is fanning the flames of a fallen system, and the flesh is hungering to have old feelings come back. And the word implanted in you is your defense. It's your God-given shield to repulse temptation's power. And it's your God-given instinct to lead against the impulses that are within you from the fallen man. So to overcome temptation, I have to demand in myself that I act on the truth and I don't act on half-truths. So here's what he says in verse 20. The anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. By the way, I would put in the word ever. I don't think there's any time ever that people's anger brings about the righteousness of God. Because I don't have a way of getting angry with something without having my ego involved. By the way, lots of Christians disagree with me. They have this category they call righteous indignation. I frankly don't see any case for righteous indignation that doesn't include my ego. I am not angry when someone abuses a child. I'm hurt. I'm not trying to find a way to revenge, because revenge is not mine. Anger leads me to revenge. Hurt leads me to try and figure out how to help. And here's the truth. That person is fallen. They are broken. I am broken in other areas. And if we highlight my areas, they won't be better. They'll just be different. So ultimately, I look at this and I go, the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. So I have to take responsibility for my sin. I have to slow down. I have to listen. I have to not respond quickly. And I need to understand that if I respond in anger, it's not going to lead the right direction. Go to verse, we're almost ready for break. Therefore, putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness and humility, receive the word implanted, which is able to save your souls. That's a great verse, by the way. He says, I need to take off filthiness and I need to get rid of all the remains of the stain of wickedness and then nurture the word that's implanted. Why? Because the seeds of the fallen man are also implanted. In other words, whichever seeds I water, those are the ones that'll grow. I'm supposed to water the seeds of the word. Let me say this. And when I first got my very first Bible, my mom wrote in the front of it, says, "This book will keep you from sin, and sin will keep you from this book." It's that simple. It really is. As you allow the Word of Christ to dwell in you richly in all things, you will speak to one another in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, and your relationships to one another will be godly. As you allow your mind to feast on the world's lyrics, you will find yourself thinking like the world. So be careful. Allow yourself to pass through the world without becoming part of it. And here it says, prove yourselves doers of the word. Did you notice what he said? Don't be theoretical. Take your Bible study and ask this question every day. Lord, what would you have me do about what I'm learning? What am I supposed to do with this? The Bible was not meant to be read and studied. It was meant to be lived. What do you do with it? And not merely hearers, because hearers delude themselves. I would put next to verse 22 in my own thinking, churches are filled with hearers. Churches are filled with deluded people. They're people who think they're okay because they sit where the word is preached. That's different than doing it. Honestly, people feel good about themselves just going and hearing the word. They'll come out and they'll go, "Oh, that was a great service. I really feel good now." They haven't done anything. You sat in a chair, okay? It's when you go out and do something with the word that you actually become part of the battle. Verse 23, if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like the man who looks at his natural face in the mirror, but once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. Obviously, you know that that doesn't require a lot of explanation. Bottom line is, if you look in the mirror and you realize that you have spinach stuck to the side of your face and you don't take it off, you walk away with no benefit having looked into the mirror because it's stuck to the side of your face and you look stupid. Verse 25, one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this man will be pleased in what he does. If anyone thinks himself to be righteous, yet does not bridle his tongue, he deceives his own heart. So there's a whole thing about forgetting what the word says. Now in verse 26, he moves to the tongue, and this is the first time he will mention the tongue. He mentions the tongue a number of times, and part of what he said was, he said, if you don't bridle your tongue. What is a bridle for? Control. Here's what I want you to know. Being a Christian will do nothing to help you automatically have better speech. You can be a Christian and speak terribly. Bridling your tongue is not the act of the Holy Spirit. It is the act of the Christian. What did I just say? You can't blame the Holy Spirit when you speak badly. It's not his fault. God didn't call the Spirit of God to bridle your tongue. He called you to bridle your tongue. So when you speak badly, don't make excuses. Get the disciplines to bridle your tongue. Verse 27, pure and undefiled religion in the sight of our God and Father is this, to visit orphans and widows and keep oneself unstained by the world. Do you see three things? This is what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to practically visit orphans, practically visit widows, and practically keep yourself unstained by the world. All three of them, not just one. In other words, look at weak people and care for them. Look at yourself and take care of yourself and walk as you ought to walk. Why do you mix those two? How many of you would understand people who would become very involved in people ministries, but their heart might not be right toward the people they're ministering to? There can be something very ungodly about their godly appearance of help, okay? In youth group terms, some people are going to be incredibly loving, but what they really are is looking for a date. That's what they're doing. There's going to be people who do the right thing for the wrong reason. So he says, do the right thing, but do it with the right heart, because that's what's going to be necessary. Okay, we're going to come back to another trouble. So let's say we have the trouble, issue number one, mark it in your text, verses 2 through 12 is the issue of trials. That's the first issue. The second issue from verses 13 to 18 is the issue of temptations. The third issue in verses 19 to 27 is the issue of taking responsibility.